Can you hear me as well? Yosan, Yosan, is it okay?
Yeah. Sorry about that.
Okay, it's okay. So, all right. Okay, I try to make this very, because we're not so many people, if you want to ask questions at any time, you can. I will maybe answer them in two or three questions, but don't, you can interrupt me at any time. Because usually I'm talking too fast. So if I talk too fast, also you can tell me that I should speak slower, because many people, they don't understand what I'm saying if I'm talking too fast. But I noticed that in Singapore, actually, people, they always talk too fast. So I think you have no problem with me. And in Singapore also, they ask everybody always, what did you say? What did you say? It's like nobody understands each other. And I'm very, but I still like Singapore a lot. So yeah, it's an amazing city. So actually, I'm here this week and last week because I'm setting up a Singapore office for us. Not with staff right now, but we want to do more in Singapore for our target. So we also set up a Singapore presence right now. And we also have been accredited with .sg, which is SG NIC. So if you go to this page, I think. Yeah. SG NIC. Does everybody know what's SG NIC?
No.
Okay, so you have .com. So we are domain name registrar. So domain name registrars, these are the people who help you to register a domain name. The most popular one is probably GoDaddy. Everybody knows them, but they're not very good. We are much better. And unbiased, okay? We are much better, okay? And but you also have so-called country top-level domain names like .sg for Singapore, .tw for Taiwan, .cn for China, and even .us for the USA, which is not so popular. You won't see any company in the US who's using .us, or not so much, maybe a local company. And even in China, you don't see so many companies who are actually using a .cn, like Taobao uses a .com, Alibaba uses a .com, Baidu is using a .com. So I think the Chinese government is like, why nobody's using .cn? So because I think it's mainly about, okay, how the internet grow and also what people start to get familiar with. And so for .sg, you can see right now they only have like nine registrars, maybe 12 or more. Okay, yeah. So we're going to be there. You see, there's a spot reserved for us. and we're going to be there. So we're going to be one of them. And as you can see, all of these companies, they have a Singapore office and a phone number. Yeah. And SGNIC reports to the so-called IMDA. They used to be MEDA something, and they merged to IMDA. I'm the authority, right? That's what it means. And yeah, but they are quite nice to work with. So if you create a company, they have a free service that they propose to some registrar where you can register a free .sg domain name. But don't buy one now because you can have to wait until we are really accredited and you can get it from us. Yeah, and yeah, so that's for .sg. And so about Gandi. I can give you a little introduction about us. So we are mainly a domain name registrar, and that's really 80% of all our business. So we've been created in 1999 in France, and I'm not French, I'm actually German. And I started the Asia business unit in 2014. So the Asia business unit is based in Taipei, and it was my idea that they should also have a Taipei office. So I met them and I told them, hey, maybe you should have a Taiwan office because Asia is kind of cool and it kind of sucks that you're not there. So they say, yeah, we agree. So I do it for them. And since that time, we also have a Taipei office, and we translated the entire website to Chinese. So right now, our website is available in traditional Chinese, simplified Chinese, English, French, and Spanish. And later this year, we will also add Japanese to the website. Because obviously in Japan, there's many people who like to buy domain names. So even if it's a mature market, it's a very interesting market for us. And so right now, our offices are in Paris, Luxembourg, San Francisco, and Taipei. And our DNS and hosting infrastructure right now is in three countries or cities. But we're probably going to roll out more during the coming years. For us, hosting has not been a very high priority. Hosting means like where you can store your websites and where you can store your data and your WordPress and whatever. But even if the website is in Luxembourg, you can use a CDN. And you can, even if you host a website there with some latency, you can still serve it to customers in Singapore or wherever you are. Yeah. So that's who we are. And our company slogan is no bullshit. So it's a trademark, and the idea of that is that you can it means like we're not making your life too complicated. We're not trying to sell you everything like all the time, like, hey, buy this domain name now because it's so cheap, and we're not going to spam you to death, meaning like you're not going to get an email, hey, buy it now, now it's this offer, now it's this offer. So we have some customers that don't hear us for maybe since 1 year because they didn't subscribe to our newsletter. And so for me, the newsletter is really important, because if we wouldn't have the newsletter, we wouldn't talk to our customers. But so we are against spam, and we are also against which I think makes us very different, because we're not acting that commercially like other companies do. So we don't do advertisement, but we mainly rely on the word of mouth. So if I tell someone, hey, use our domain name registrar, and they see like, okay, it works very well, and the service is good, then our growth is from there, because other people will tell other people that they should buy the domain name from us. And
Was it intentional to keep your newsletters only text? Like, I noticed there were no images.
I think it has been more of a technical issue. Nobody ever had the time or the feeling like, hey, it makes sense that we also have an HTML.
Oh.
But we usually, what we do is we redirect now to the website to show the HTML version.
Oh, okay.
And then we just have it there on the browser, which is easier and better to display. Because having HTML email seems to be a science for itself, especially with images. So in Outlook and Thunderbird and, I don't know, even once upon some old Zimbra clients or whatever, it looks very differently how the HTML email is displayed.
Okay.
Microsoft developed their own Microsoft HTML, which they don't want anyone to use anymore now,
okay.
But it's still in the market. And once you started something technically, it's there, right? So you can't really get rid of it. Just like Windows XP took like 20 years to kill, right?
Oh.
So and I'm sure they still use it somewhere. So, but
when you look at HTML emails, there's a few specialized software that helps you to create marketing emails. And you look at the HTML it creates, I say you want to want it.
Oh.
This is really, really bad. But it shows in all the email softwares from 1995 to today, okay-ish.
Hmm.
Oh.
But the HTML is.
So yeah, it's really a science for itself.
Trademark is not registered. That's why you put TM.
Yeah. It's a trademark. Yeah,
it's registered. It's not registered. If you're not registered, you can register and put the R.
Oh, maybe yeah. Some people they put the R. Some people put the TM. I don't know what's the difference between those.
It's whether registered. Yeah, you intend to use a trademark but not registered. It's a TM. Registered is a R.
Oh, so maybe I should use the R.
Yeah.
But the TM is more nice looking, I think. So as I mentioned, we do that. And the way we also do, we support open source, or the way we do support open source, we support the projects. For example, software developers who work on the Debian project, they can email us from the debian.org email address, also freebsd.org, also netbsd now. They can email us from the email address if they are a contributor, and we give them a lower rate for registering domain names, so they get our lowest rate. So they don't have to buy millions of domain names to get a very cheap price, but they can contact us and say, okay, hey, I'm working on open source, can I have a cheaper price?
Oh, really?
Yeah. We also support Debian, the World Wildlife Fund, which is supporting pandas and someone else, I think. And Spamhaus is an organization which is against spam. So it's a cooperation between technical engineers, police, who works on fighting professional spam. So there's some people all over the world who professionally helps people to send out billions of emails every day. I'm sure you receive some of them every day. I have them every day. So I spend like maybe every day like 2 minutes deleting emails, so which I didn't want. So spam remains a big problem. We support the Electronic Frontier Foundation, the EFF, which not so many people know in outside of the US, I think, but they basically support for network neutrality, that the operators don't start to cap the bandwidth and say, hey, because you don't pay a higher price, your speed is going to be very low. I think in Singapore, you don't have so many operators, maybe one or two, right? So here it's a bit different, and the bandwidth might be higher than what you can get from some operators in the US or Europe. But in Europe or in the US now, the trend is that you have to pay extra if you want extra data. If you want extra speed, you have to pay extra. So they try to make it more difficult for customers to have the service which actually the line supports. But what online freedom, that there's no limitation how you express your rights, that there's no website blocking from the government and things like that. So they fight for that and we support them. We support VLC, which is a video player. Most people know VLC, but they don't know it's actually from France, the company. And they set up an office in our office. So in our office in France, they have our office inside it.
Okay.
Yeah. And we also, and for most of these projects you see here, they also have their domain names with us. So if you do a whois on debian.org, you will see it's registered with Gandi. Oh. Yeah. And same for VideoLAN and the EFF. Okay, yeah. And we also support FOSS Asia.
And we moved all our domains to Gandi just a few months ago. So I think we have over 30 different domains, but I'm not really thank you very much for your support.
Thank you. Yeah, thank you for doing this.
Question.
Yes.
Did you get them to use your services or was it the other way around? They chose?
I think they choose us. Mostly they choose us. Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Because sometimes in open source they're also a bit jealous, or maybe the people they see like, hey, you already support Ubuntu, you already support Debian, why don't you also support FreeBSD? Oh. And then the NetBSD people see it and say like, hey, the FreeBSD people are using Gandi, we want to have the discount as well, so they contact us. I think it's like word of mouth as well, because once people see like, okay, the service works and the programmers talk to each other, then they know, okay, we can trust this company and we can also do our service with them. Because it's very hard I think it's very hard in the domain name industry to find someone you can trust from the registrar sometimes. Because domain names are a very gray area. Before I joined the domain name industry, I was working as an engineer in a company, as a project manager in a company in Taipei. But for me, domain name registrars, they were always like companies who are selling shoes. You know, so it's like, you can buy them different colors, different size, but afterwards I see, okay, there's some companies who are different. Who are a little bit more real to the world and say like, okay, you can register your domain name. And it's basically just a registration service, not something which is like you have to buy so many things additionally to make it work. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So we try to include a lot of services with a domain name. And the basic services like email, they are free with us. If you apply for Google Suite, for example, like, you know, Google also does Gmail. With the client is kind of okay on the web, I think, but you can also use IMAP. But once you want to use your own domain name, Google will charge you for the service monthly. Okay. And it might be okay as well, but with our service, you already have it included with the domain name. So you can already register aliases, unlimited aliases, and you have two mailboxes included. And for most people, that's enough. Mm-hmm. For the small businesses or for small companies. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So the product we have is we have 720 plus TLDs. Does anyone have an idea what TLDs means? Wow, okay, I'm with smart people today. Okay. So top.
I kind of forgot what it meant.
So top level domain name is like .com, .net, .org, .sg. So that's top level. And usually I try to avoid this, to use the abbreviations, but we always use them because we are exposed to them every day. And we manage 2 million domain names. Because we exist since 1999, so 2 million domain names sounds like a lot, but in the world there's maybe totally of 300 million domain names. And there's 200 million.com. But most of these domain names are actually not used. So there's many people who just register, I think like broadcast.com, and they're just hoping that at someday they find someone who will buy the domain name. So there's a very big aftermarket, there's a very big back order market where companies at one day they want to have it. For example, Apple used to have apple.co.uk. And the guy who owned apple.co.uk, he was not giving it away, because he himself registered a computer repair shop which was called Apple Computers, and Apple could have no legitimate reason that he should give away his domain name, because Apple arrived after him with their trademark in the UK. But at some point I think maybe 3 or 4 years ago, he gave it away for some undisclosed sum. Yeah. But if you own a domain name of a company and you have the legitimate use, and maybe you also have a trademark in your country, then you have no problems even to register some international brand name. Because the thing is with brands and also with trademarks is you can only register them in specific classes. Classes means so-called NIS class, which means like there's a convention for trademarks called NIS convention. T-shirts have a different registration number than, for example, mouse pads or computers. So it would be totally okay if you make a computer brand which is called No Bullshit, you register the trademark, and we register a t-shirt at the same time which has No Bullshit, and it's also a trademark. Because it will not be confusing, and it will not be, the customer will know, okay, there's No Bullshit computers, there's No Bullshit t-shirts, and maybe there's no bullshit real estate or whatever. But if you want to register a domain name, there's only one nobullshit.com. So that's why it's tricky with trademarks and with the different domain names, and that's also why there are so many domain names. Because trademarks holders, they need to protect themselves in almost every space. And we also do SSL. So SSL certificates, we are sub-authority of Komodo. And every domain name you register comes with a free SSL certificate for 1 year. And for the hosting side, we have simple hosting, so it's platform as a service. You can use it to install WordPress, basically. And it's with MySQL PHP, what you need for WordPress, or you can have it with different databases like MongoDB or Postgres for other type of CMS like Drupal, Django, or even for your own web-based apps, if you want to use some MPQQ service, some messaging services, or whatever. So you can use our simple hosting for that. And we also have VPS, so you can install a server using our API or using our website. And there's some details here. Like we also have load balancer, multiple network interface with VLANs, and some of this stuff is also open sourced. But I'm not talking too much about hosting today because it's a very, very big topic for itself.
Yeah.
Yeah. Any question about our product?
Would you elaborate on the Git?
Git? Yeah. So we have you can access your simple hosting instance with Git, or you can deploy a Git object on the simple hosting instance. That means you save the Git object on our Git server.
Yeah.
And if you use the command git deploy, you will deploy it to a vhost on the platform as a service. So you can basically have a website like a pyramid or maybe even a Django app, which you updated using Git. And once you enter the command deploy, it will untar or unzip the directory from the Git repository directly on our platform as a service. So you have Git integration into our pass. Like you can use it for Heroku, I think is similar.
Any question about Heroku? Ask me. I work for Salesforce.
Heroku what?
Any question about Heroku? Ask me. Yeah. I work for Salesforce.
I don't know if it's compatible in some way, but yeah, you can use it.
And I say, Git is pretty cool. For instance, I say, I just throw out my database for the blog. When you comment on my blog, you actually create a Git commit in the background. And the pull request, and if I like your comment, I approve it. If not, I reject it. And it straight away deploys out.
So he's getting all the merge requests all day.
Gotcha.
people don't talk that much on my blog.
Oh.
Okay. Yeah.
But it's open source.
We use open source, for all of this. So actually all this infrastructure you see here, there's nothing is using our commercial software.
Really?
Yeah. We have some commercial software which we use for anti-DDoS. Some of our core routers, they're not open sourced, or some of the critical network infrastructure is not having open source on it. But for our products itself, we are always using open source.
Mm-hmm.
And some of our scripts, of course, they're proprietary and we don't publish them. Because maybe they're not because they're too sensitive, but they are maybe too not interesting enough, because you can't really replicate the same thing if you wanted to build it again. So our website, for example, the WHO website, is not open source right now, but actually we kind of want it. So at one point, maybe we make our website open source as well.
Okay.
So we are very open with open source. And for example, if you go to status.gandi.net, the website which is showing our status, like the infrastructure status, that one is open sourced as well. We have an internal HR management tool, that one is open sourced. So we try a lot to have everything we develop internally to have it open sourced as well.
Yeah.
And it's not just to give back, but mainly also because we are already involved with open source, so for us it's natural that we send some patches or that we make some modifications.
Sure.
For example, we use a webmail which is called Sogo. I don't know if anyone uses Sogo. Some people use Roundcube. Okay, so there's two webmail. One is let me see, maybe I can show you.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so this is round cube. It looks very old because it's very old, and you can. But there is support like hundreds of languages,
yeah.
And there's this one is not responsive. So then there's Sogo. This is another webmail client, and you can see. Okay, you have it in French, you have it in English, and so what we did is we added a Chinese translation to this one. And we gave it to the company which is developing this one. They're based in Montreal, so in Canada. Mm-hmm. And we gave them the Chinese translation file for this one. So we translated it to Chinese, and they're very happy that we provided them a Chinese version.
Sure.
And so you can see this is the web client. Looks like Gmail, right? No, it's actually better than Gmail because I mean you also have a calendar, you also have all the integration you need. So this is our webmail client. Yeah, and it's open source. So actually, if you want, you can install this software yourself. And you say, like, hey, some features Gandhi's using, I also want to use it. So maybe in the end, you install your own VPS, and maybe you install this one and use it with your domain name. So, but if you want it, you can build it yourself or run it yourself.
Sure.
Yeah. So it's not like some proprietary system, which we're using. Okay, let's go back to this. So as I mentioned, each domain name you have comes with 1 gigabyte of space and 5 mailboxes. So that's for the mailbox. You have 1,000 mail forwarding addresses, 1,000, but you can actually create more. You have a basic website included, private domain registration with most top level domain names. That always changes. For example, .io, they remove that you can have a private domain name service. So they don't want people to use a private domain name service anymore. I don't know why, but that's what I said. It means basically that your information is not shown in the Whois.
Oh.
And we have free customer service, obviously, by email. We try to support DNSSEC on most top-level domain names. This is for better security of the domain name itself. So everything which you send is a DNS record. If the client support is that the records are signed. So you know that it's really coming from them because it's signed by the root top-level domain name. It's a bit technical, yeah. And how many of you are developers on how to do software?
At one point.
Okay, maybe 4. So, you too? Okay. So I'm not surprised.
I mean, your email address is also have domain name. I mean, it's dot whatever.
Yeah. And so you can. The thing is, many people when they buy a domain name, they think it's only for a website. But you can actually use a domain name also for your email. So if, especially even in Europe or maybe even in some very developed markets, you always see the people where they still use the email address like gmail.com or they still use the email address of their own local provider, maybe singtel.sg or I don't know what's the email address people use, or yahoo.fr, gmail.com. I don't know what's the most common here. Is it Singtel or...? Maybe Gmail, probably Gmail. Yeah. But you can use a domain name also for email, and you can have your own aliases. The good thing about the aliases is that sometimes maybe you want to sign up for some event, and maybe hey, these people, they are so marketing oriented, already received 20 emails to subscribe to the event. So you can create an alias, like not FOSS Asia, this not like this, but maybe you can create, something like Cloud Expo HK at, and then use your own domain name.com or .shop or whatever. And then if you register it, you can always get the emails redirected there. And once the conference is over, and you so that I do that all the time. So, yeah. Or you can create a domain name only for receiving spam mail. Yeah. But that's what the aliases are for. Okay. Okay. So any more question about the product? I mean, the topic is making money with FOSS, right? So, I think that covers that part because that's how we are, who we are. The thing is also you can use our APIs. So that's what we go on with. So our APIs is we have a command line interface, and we have a API. So command line interface is you can type the comment, and our system using your API key will execute the comment. And it's using the API as well. So our command line interface is also open sourced. And you can find it on cli.gandi.net and also on GitHub. And so you can you download it with, I get to the steps. So the first thing you have to do to activate the API, you need to go to our website. But this is our old website, so I used our old website. We have the website, which is a shiny one, fancy one, I showed you before. That one is the new one we rolled out earlier last year. And this is our old one, which is a bit easier right now to create the API key. So you basically log into the website. Is that clear enough? You create a handle, so a handle is a username on the new website. You say, okay, which language you speak. So you see, we support only 5 languages right now. Sure. And once you're inside, you can activate the OT&E and production API. So this may be too technical for some of you, but once you have created this, okay, let's go through this. You're gonna get the API key, and if you copy the API key, you will be able to use it with the command line interface. Because once you set up the command line interface, the Gandi CLI, you can use it for all the operations.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What are some use cases you see for the CLI?
Oh, yeah. So we have, okay, this is the installation process. I'm not sure if it's so interesting for you. It's just basically you use Python to download it, set up, enter your API key. And for example, the comments you can use is Gandi VM create or Gandi pass create to create a new hosting instance. One is a VPS and the other one is for like installing a WordPress or setting up a WordPress on the command line. So if you say like, okay, hey, I have an app which my company uses, but sometimes the website is always the same, but we have the same event maybe in different places, or we have a calendar system, or any kind of system you can think of which you need to regularly deploy on different websites, or maybe you have customers on your own which use a website, like this was mainly done for our resellers. Maybe you also want to create a VPS or a platform as a service in some way. So you can use our CLI to create those, but also to maintain them. So maybe you need to reboot it, maybe you need to add more space, maybe you need to check something on it if it's working, or you need to configure load balancer. So that's what the CLI is for.
Mm-hmm. As opposed to going to the website.
Yeah, correct. Yeah. Okay. So I don't think we have the complete mapping of all the functions from our website inside the CLI, and it's not really our goal because we don't have enough people to focus on it. But I think the CLI is quite complete right now.
So one area where you want to use the CLI is if you have a bit of a more complex application you want to test. So you were a good boy and you wrote your unit tests, no? And you were a good boy and you built your integration tests, and then you realize, oh fuck, it doesn't work if you don't have the same data all the time. So you use the CLI, put it into your Jenkins server or into your Travis or wherever, and then always start with the same set of data, with the same set environment, then you can run your integration tests fully automated. Mm-hmm. And I say, even if you very happily use the UI as a user, the very moment you want to automate something, you have to use the CLI. And I say, when software gets a little bit more complex, you will be very, very happy that you have this capability.
Sure.
You can also use it to, let's say you run a web server and you know that every Saturday, Sunday, the traffic is going up or it's peaking, or maybe you run some other operations which needs a lot of CPU. Maybe like, okay, so you upload images to a server and the images need to be resized, or maybe some image detection, use it for machine vision. Then maybe you need to change the CPU cores as well. So you can use the CLI to modify on the fly how many cores of CPU you want to use. And of course, if you use more, we will charge you more. If you use less, then you will charge you less. So it's maybe in your interest to say, okay, hey, I'm using the CLI to detect how is the CPU load, and if it's getting too high, I'm just using a comment to reduce it. So you can put this into a cron, you can put this into a monitoring script, and you can dynamically allocate your resources. And yeah, that's basically it. So if you use, for example, if you use the comment VM info, you can see what is the information about about the VM. So this was at Hong Kong Open Source Conference last year. So I show, okay, there is the 256 memory only. It's a very small server with two cores. And you can see the IPv4 and IPv6 address and what is the network interface speed. So it's like 1 gigabit. No, 1 megabit. And the disk which is on it, the system disk. So it's a 3 gigabyte disk in that case.
Is it a Docker or something else?
Yeah. You can use it with Docker images as well. Yeah, so you can. So what you saw here is if you have if you call Gandi VM create, yep, and you select the right image, you can actually say, okay, you can name the image, what's the basic image you want, and with --run, you can say what is the image you want to deploy. So you can actually have your own kernel images, you can have your own modified, customized images. And if you find a Docker image somewhere, you can use it directly. So any Docker app which is compatible with our images, will which are mostly Linux, they will work right away. So if you have a Docker images for or Salesforce Docker image, so then you can then you could use them. Yeah. I think there's a lot of Docker images for all kind of stuff, like maybe some I don't know how popular Docker is right now or still is, but we have
there's an image for that.
There's probably an image for that if you need it. Yeah. We celebrate Docker's birthday, I think, end of this month in our office as well.
Oh, really?
And they get a birthday cake and some people come. Yeah. Yeah. We know some people from there. This is the comment you can use for a domain. For the domain, it's quite simple, the comments.
Yeah.
You can just get the information of a domain name, yeah, and you can create a domain name.
Wow.
That's for the CLI right now. Okay. I forgot if we already added a renew comment. Maybe we did. Mm-hmm. But you can also use the command line interface to create domain names.
Sure.
So let's say, yeah.
Just a bit confused. Actually, you're doing your hosting in the domain, right?
So yeah. Yeah.
So just we move to the Docker images. How I interrelate two things?
With our CLI, you can use every product. That means you can use domain names, you can use hosting, you can use certificates, okay, you can use mailboxes. So you can use the API also to create a mailbox, which is attached to a domain name. But the mailbox itself doesn't have anything to do with a domain name. The service, like the hosting of the email and so on, has nothing to do with a domain name or the DNS itself. So but we added all these comments inside our command line interface, and one API key is enough to manage all of them. So to manage your account, it's just one API key, and you can access all the different services which are under the account. Okay. So for the certificate, we also have you can list your certificate, you can delete them, you can create them. This is for the SSL certificates. And for the VM, you have start, stop, delete, create, info. So these are all the comments you can use to manage your virtual machines. And other comments. So we have Gandi pass, Gandi VLAN, Gandi mail, and some maintenance comments like a Gandi oper to see like what are the ongoing operations, to query what is the, maybe some comment fail, or you want to see if the comment already is finished. So you can use Gandi oper to see like if there's an operation to increase the CPU, if it has really finished. Okay, so that's the part. Any question about this CLI?
I'm just curious how long this development took you to write a CLI.
We already had an API, so
okay.
It wasn't that complicated, I think. Sure. But we can look at GitHub and see how much is the history. I think releasing the first alpha version and the real release version, maybe 2 years totally. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It was open source from the beginning.
Yeah. But it didn't have its own website. CLI.gandi.net only exists since like 2 years maybe.
Oh.
But it was always available before on GitHub.
Oh.
Mm. And so you can just get it from GitHub directly, and you can see what is the changes to it.
Sure.
If you go to, let me see, before I go to domain API. Yeah, so this is our GitHub account, and If you look at the CLI, so it hasn't been modified since a long time.
Oh, okay. January 31st.
So you can also see the history of the community. Okay, there's some parameters for the domain control validation have been changed. So you can now use Gandi record update to update the domain record. And if you go to, I don't think there's a way to show the oldest.
Yeah.
But you can see it's quite mature and quite long time that we work on it. December 2015. Goes way back, okay.
Yeah, okay.
Okay, so this is our GitHub account. You can also check this. I recently added this one. This is an open search plugin. You can use it yourself, actually. It's a if you look at the XML file, this is open source, but actually it's just a script. Oops, no. This looks like this because this is an image. Okay, so but basically the most important part is over here, which is the URL to search for a domain name. So what I added is like if you click on Firefox, you click over here in the right corner on the top. And for example, you search for FOSS Asia. Here you have the suggestion to use Gandi.net to search. So you have Google, and here you have Gandi.net. So this is what I added. So if you know any service where you can query for some information, you can use this kind of plugin, or you can even make your own for Firefox to search for whatever you need.
Only for Firefox?
I think it also works with Internet Explorer and Chrome. I'm not sure if they support it. But this is a open search is a new standard. I think maybe around since a year or two, and they have a specific XML description. Let me see.
You have one search engine, or you are using another search engine to?
We use our own.
Really?
That's cool. It's actually a very complicated thing because we have a guy in our office. He made his PhD with the domain search engine, but we are not giving so much suggestion based on what is the cheapest domain or what is the best domain name.
Yeah.
If you just search for domain name, for example, let's say you could look for hacker FOSS. What we do is we use the location you are currently at. For example, you're in Singapore, and we just suggest what are the most used domain names in Singapore. And it will change a little bit over time as well, because I expect that more people will buy .sg domain name with us. But here you can see what are the most popular domain names in Singapore. Okay. So .com, .io, .eu, .pw, .club, .online. Those are the most popular ones of our customers here.
$16, that's like a few Singapore cents,
right? I don't know how much it's in Singapore. Okay. Actually, I don't even know why it shows in... Okay, because I'm logged in. Okay. So let me see. 200 is 12, like almost 13 Singapore dollar.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So
16. Yeah. So here I can just say, okay, I add it to my basket. One product should be two. And then when I edit them, I can just say check out. Okay, you're going to buy them on my behalf. You can create a new organization. And you see the differences to other operators is now, if you work with another registrar, they would ask you now, okay, do you want to add this and that? Do you already add it? They already added to you with pre-checked. We ask you to try our hosting as well, and you can add it. But it's not like pre-checked. Most operators, they will pre-check. It's like, buy extra security, have extra mailboxes, have extra stuff, SSL included, whatever. So we don't do that. Okay. So if I just accept the contracts here, And I will say check out. Don't ask for any other bullshit. So because there's no bullshit. And you can, we support credit cards from the prepaid account, Amex. We don't support Nets. Does Nets work online actually?
It's a pain in the butt. Don't bother.
Okay. Okay. So is old school or is it
just a pain in the butt.
I know the banks are very expensive here. I notice it's like all the services that everything costs extra, right? Yeah.
Sure. If you like, maybe there's some API from Nets you can use. I'm not sure if it's register key for it.
Okay.
Now, if it works, actually, if you implement your own Gandi website, it's like you can generate that QR code, and then people can use that.
It's a bit like WeChat Pay or Alipay, or
That's probably easier.
We use a third party redirect people to them. But it's still complicated many times. Because for every API you use, you need to pass some test and some integration. So it's not easy. We also support Bitcoin. In Singapore, is Bitcoin legal or okay, or they don't know?
Technically not regulated.
Technically, yeah. Okay. Yeah, it sounds like most countries. But we support Bitcoin Cash and Bitcoin, the normal Bitcoin. I don't know if it's split again. Sometimes they do. So we support Bitcoin. I think Bitcoin Cash is now also supported with BitPay. So if we use BitPay as our payment operator for Bitcoin. So we don't actually support Bitcoin, but it's routed through BitPay. And they will give us US dollar. So right away. So we are happy with Bitcoins. Okay. I'm already over time, or is it still okay? I think I'm over time. Hong Fuk, it's your turn. I think I'm almost done. Yeah. But okay, so just to show you, we have a. So after you register domain name with us, you find your domain names in the domain dashboard. So this is our new website. And here I can see all the domain names I own. So for example, I own the domain night.market.
Is it inspired from the time in
Thailand? Maybe. I have night.market and night.markets. So there's new top level domain names, maybe over 500 now. So one of them is .market.
Oh.
So I just thought night.market would have a funny name. I haven't used it yet in any way. Okay. Cool. I also have taipei.beer and munich.beer.
Oh.
So but no, maybe it's going to be valuable someday, but maybe, or maybe use it. I was thinking about using taipei.beer. Maybe I'm just going to say which beer you can buy at which restaurant. Because some restaurants, maybe they have a Duvel, maybe some other restaurant. It's usually cheaper than buying it in, I don't know. So that's my plan. I'm a German, so we focus a lot on beer products. So that's how you can use a domain name. And if you click on a domain name here, you can change the name servers, you can change the domain contacts. And you can also configure the email boxes.
Sure.
So it's quite easy to set up. And nothing like, okay, there's no extra steps, no extra frills, or no things which ask you to pay extra for any service if you want to. If I click on create here, it's not going to ask me to, hey, you need to buy a mailbox. It's already included.
Oh.
And if you want to buy additional mailboxes, you can go on the, where was that? Actually, I don't know. I don't know how to buy more mailboxes because the ones who are included, they show you here. Maybe it was an overview. Okay. Well, that's it. Okay. So that's a basic introduction for our product. I could also show you the domain API, but I think it's not so interesting for the audience over here. Basically, but what you can do is if you say, okay, I want to sell my own domain names through Gandi, you can also use our API to offer other people on your website to buy a domain name. So you can become a reseller of us. And So this is the basic sample code to have to see if a domain name is available and to register it. So this is in Python, I think. Yeah, it's Python. So you just say, okay, what is your currency you're using? What is your API key? And you just call API domain price to get the price from our website. Then you check if the domain name is available. Domain price actually will tell you if the domain is available. And this sample just prints the result if it found it. So this is a simple check, okay, how to buy the domain name. And you can see, okay, the phase is go live. So right now it's already existing, you can register it. And it would tell if it's available. And this is the parameter, this is the array. People who are not programmers here, don't be shocked. This is just like an Excel file, but it's shown in a different way, okay? And it's just showing you, okay, the price is this, and then you could register it. Yeah. This is simplified. Normally you would have to do much more checks and make sure that everything in the array is correct.
Oh.
And and this is how it looks on the comment line, this sample. Okay, yeah, and maybe I'll show you this as well. So on doc.rpc.gandi.net, we have information how to use our API. So for the domain creation is this little workflow. Just call domain available, and if it's available, then you have to create a contact. So you make a contact create over here, and once the contact has been created, come back to here. You call the function domain create with the attached owners, and you check if the operation is running, if it's working, and if it's in this step done, the domain name is registered. You can call domain name info, and the domain name is there. Oh, that's basically it. Okay, and that's all for my talk, I think, for now.